Good evening. We welcome all of you, and again, we want to remind you that only when there are public hearings do we allow public comments. However, if there's something you want to talk about or say something about, please send an email to Maureen O'Meara, the town planner. We get every word that anybody ever writes to us, believe me, and we read every word that everybody writes to us. And we try to take into consideration all the things we need to, but again, I have to remind you, we must follow the zoning code. Anyway, okay, we have correspondence this evening, but before we do that, the minutes of the last meeting, are there any corrections or additions? A motion, please.
Move that we accept the minutes as presented.
Second? Yes. All in favor? Opposed? We have correspondence this evening. We have a letter to R. St. Pierre, Reed Jonesy's, a letter from W. Marshall regarding the Inn by the Sea, a memorandum from the town manager regarding the Crescent Beach facility, a memorandum from the code enforcement officer regarding the Inn by the Sea, and the rest of it was just internal information. Our first item is a consent agenda item. Yes, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. The memorandum from the town manager, is that not with regard to Canyon Creek, not Crescent Beach? I have a memorandum to Maureen, town planner, from Mike McGovern regarding Canyon Creek, not Crescent Beach.
Yes, but Canyon Creek is the applicant for the Crescent Beach.
Gotcha. Okay.
Thank you. Okay, the first item on the agenda is the Jordan Family Subdivision. The Jordan Family would like to amend the previous approved three-lot subdivision located at the end of Deer Run Road to include a phasing plan. I would like to remind the board that if a board member wants to have a substantive discussion, the motion should be, we should have a motion to made to move the application to the regular agenda. Anybody have anything that they want to have discussed with this project? And may we have a motion for the board to consider, please?
Barbara?
Paul?
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Jordan family to amend the previously approved Jordan subdivision located at the end of Deer Run Road to create a phasing plan be approved.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. The second item is also a consent agenda item. Stephen Parkhurst is requesting an amendment to the previously approved Cross Hill subdivision to realign the common property line for lots 96 and 97 located at 2 and 4 Peppergrass Road. This would be an amendment to a previously approved subdivision. Again, I want to remind the board that if we want to have a discussion, a substantive discussion about this, we have to move it to a regular agenda. Is there anybody who, if not, may we have a motion for the board to consider?
Madam Chair? Yeah. I'll move that it be ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented that the application of Cross Hill LLC to amend the common boundaries of of lots 96 and 97 located at 2 and 4 Peppergrass Road in the Cross Hill subdivision be approved.
Second?
Scott? Second.
All in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. And the third consent agenda item is Margaret Dietz of 1198 Sawyer Road and Richard and Heidi Herrera of 1206 Sawyer Road would like to amend their common boundary line so that a paved area on the Dietz lot could be used as a driveway for the Herrera lot. It's an amendment to a previously approved subdivision. Again, anybody who would, yes?
The motion would consider.
Zach?
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Margaret Dietz and Richard and Heidi Herrera for an amendment to the lots 3 lot line located at 1198 and 1206 Sawyer Road of the Cross Hill subdivision be approved.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. The first item of old business is the Bothell subdivision. Stephen and Patricia Bothell are requesting minor subdivision review of a proposed five-lot subdivision located at 90 to 98 Ocean House Road. And John Mitchell will tell us about any changes that have been made to the submitted plans.
All right, so, my name is John Mitchell of Mitchell & Associates, and I represent the Bothell family. Would you like me to limit my discussion to any changes? That's okay.
Please.
Okay.
Because I think at the last meeting of the board, you went through all the entire plan for us, unless anybody else feels otherwise.
Okay. There have been a few minor revisions made to the plan. Sheet 3 is a print of the final subdivision plan. The final meets and bounds have been shown on the plan, and this has been stamped by a registered surveyor. We have added three notes to the plan related to the open space pedestrian easement, which will be granted to the town, and the 50-foot wide right-of-way shown here. So those are notes 9, 10, and 11 have been added to the plan. And then the final, that's the extent of any plan changes. We have submitted in our packet two legal documents. One is an easement for the 50-foot wide right-of-way and open space B. And the second document are restrictive covenants for open space A and open space B. Open space A is located here, and open space B is located here.
You know, the stanchion there is blocking anything you can see anyway. It's terrible.
Is that better? I can't. There you go.
Can we flip these up?
You want to put them up?
Can I do
this? Can the board see this?
Yes, but anybody who can't is welcome to walk up and see.
Yeah, you can't see it now because the sun's right down here.
We can't. The problem is that we can't see it, and we have to be able to see it. I'm sorry, sir. If you would like to get up and walk over there, you're welcome.
And then, as we've mentioned in the past, we are requesting four waivers. The first is stormwater management plan. Basically, we're not proposing any additional impervious surface as part of this proposal. This is only this proposal consists of the creation of five lots, one for each of the single-family residences and one for the Bothell's mechanical store. The fifth lot is the future development land in the back. The scale of the subdivision plan, the ordinance requires 1 inch equals 40, and we're asking for a waiver. This is 1 inch equals 50 feet, and the reason for that is so that we can show the entire property on a single 24 by 36 inch sheet. The third waiver is the road name. As part of phase one, we've shown a 50-foot right-of-way. A road will not be built until such time that the future development in the back is proposed. So we've asked to hold on the naming of the road. And the last is financial capability letter. Basically, we're not showing any improvements to the property. So we didn't feel that was applicable. So that's the extent of the changes.
Thank you. We'll have the public hearing next and open the public hearing. Anybody who wishes to speak, please come to the podium and state your name and whatever you'd like to say. Oh, an address. Please state your name and address. Thank you.
I'm Angela O'Neill, and I live at Canterbury at 30 Westminster Terrace. And I guess we just don't understand, are there going to be, are these five lots that are already established? Is that what that is?
Yes.
And then this is how much land?
Approximately 12 acres.
12 acres? And that, and what is the plan for that? I mean, will that will be subdivided into other lots? Is that it?
Would you like me to address it?
There are five more lots that could be, but that is not part of the current plan. This is a phased plan right now.
Right.
But there is future potential for more lots.
And so what about right-of-ways as far as, will all of this be accessible from Ocean Road, or will there be other access roads, or?
John, do you want to respond, or?
Now, you're referring to future development?
Yes.
You're referring to this phase?
Well, I don't know, either one. I guess what we're wondering is, how is Canterbury affected? Is it affected? How close are we? I guess those are our questions.
Okay. As part of the, as the board knows, we are following the provisions of the open space zoning. And as part of the open space zoning requirements, the applicant is required to show how the future land is going to be developed. We did a calculation, a density calculation, and this property could support 17 lots in total. First of all, the applicant has no interest in developing this property in the foreseeable future. But as a requirement, we had to show the town a possible development. The access road would come off of Ocean House Road at this point and access the back land. We've shown a cul-de-sac with a total of five lots fronting on the road, and these lots meet the minimum and average lot size for open space zoning. The reason that five was chosen was Steve and Pat and the Bothells have a total of five sons or daughters, and one would be for each of them. And but this is, you know, they, as I said, they have no future plans to develop that property. This is the way that it will be, and there will not be access to the rear land until something is proposed.
So how close is it to Canterbury?
Canterbury is here. It abuts our property at this point here. This is 1 inch equals 50 feet. It's, you know, probably 300 feet to the closest lot.
So that other land would be pretty much open space?
All of this would remain open space, correct.
But I mean, even when the house is here, that...
Oh, if this occurs, right. Yes, all of this area would be open space.
John.
Okay.
Yes.
Just to clarify, the only approval sought by the applicant tonight is for phase one,
right,
which is to create the lots for the existing buildings. Phase two approval is not being granted tonight. All they were required to do, we have situations where people, and I'm sure all of you can think of them, where people own a large tract of land and chop off a piece at a time, and eventually what they do is they make a mistake in how they chop it off. And then they end up with a landlocked piece or inappropriate access. And so what we're trying to do with this approach is to make sure that property owners are looking far enough down the road with the potential full build-out, that they're dealing with basic issues of natural resources, like wetlands, access, as you've requested, how are they going to get there, and how can they lay out the lots in a logical manner. So the applicant's proposed phase two that on its face could be developed into a full project that could meet the standards, but they're not seeking approval for that now, and have said they're not planning to develop it at any time. But that doesn't mean they can't come back tomorrow. But even if they came back tomorrow, they would have to submit a full plan, and the full review process would begin with notices to all the neighbors.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who would like to speak? Would you come up and... Excuse me, would you please come to the podium and state your name and address?
I'm Steve Monahan, and I live at 29 Westminster. And we really are here mostly to be educated. But if one looks at this drawing that we have, you know, one of our members who is here tonight, it looks like this line is practically right through a backyard. And what is the worst that could come of zoning to allow to be built along that line? How close would it be to this one unit of the in Canterbury?
Can you point to it on the larger drawing, please?
Well, this isn't, you know, these are the units of Canterbury aren't on here. But the one I'm
thinking about here from Canterbury.
You know, it's not to scale, but it almost, this line almost goes right through her living room.
Dr. Monahan?
Yes.
Yeah. That you got to remember that this, what you have here, that notice, this is a pretty rough map. It's just supposed to give you an idea of the location of the project so that you know whether or not you're
Well, that's fine. But as I say, we're here for education.
That building may be shown and a lot what is closer the, to the lot line than it actually is.
I know that. Okay. But what is the ruling? I mean, what is the minimum setback that has to be from the line of Canterbury to the line of this proposed development?
Yeah, this land is in the RB district, and the RB district requires all new development to be cluster development. So we can't really tell you what the fixed setback is going to be, because it's probably going to be a lot bigger than what the normal setback would be for a traditional subdivision.
Well, and there again, is it 50 feet,
is it
75 feet, or 100 feet?
Yeah, the plan shown by Mr. Mitchell behind you shows a setback of approximately 300 feet.
Oh. Well, I think that's the thing that we're most interested in. That's 100 yards, basically. This is the length of a football field. Right.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who would like to speak? Okay. If not, the public hearing is closed. And John Mitchell, please come back to the podium. And are there any questions from the planning board? Any questions at all? May we entertain a motion, please, for the board to consider?
Barbara? Mm-hmm. Motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, number one, Stephen and Patricia Bothell are requesting minor subdivision review of a five-lot subdivision located at 90 and 98 Ocean House Road which requires review under Section 16-2-3, minor subdivision review, and Sections 19-7-2, open space zoning. Number two, the applicants will be preserving two open space parcels in compliance with the subdivision ordinance impact fee and the open space zoning provisions. Number three, the application substantially complies with Section 16-2-3, minor subdivision review, and Section 19-7-2, open space zoning provisions. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Stephen and Patricia Bothell for minor subdivision review of a 5-lot subdivision located at 90 and 98 Ocean House Road be approved, subject to the following condition. One, that the open space deeds be submitted in a form acceptable to the town attorney and signed by the applicants.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Once Mr. Mitchell gets his plans off the board, then we'll ask Mr. Deese to come forward. Mr. Tease, will you please review with us any changes you've made in the plans?
Yes, I will.
This is, just so everybody knows what it is. It's the Inn by the Sea. LLC is requesting an amendment to the previously approved site plan for an expansion that will add 15 guest rooms, parking, a utility shed, landscaping, and miscellaneous renovations to the Inn by the Sea.
Thank you. My name is...
Scott, could you please introduce yourself for the minutes? Thank you.
My name is Scott Tease. I'm the architect for the project. I'm here this evening with Steve Bradstreet, our civil engineer, Gary Hosmer, landscape architect, and Mike Zimmerman, who is with the Olympic Company, the owner's representative. We're here this evening seeking final approval for the project as described, namely the expansion of the facility plus renovations, landscaping, additional parking. Since the last meeting, there's been a site walk. I'm sure many of you have attended, and hopefully a lot of the questions were answered. We are in receipt of Marina Mira's comments, a review and comments of the project, most of which are landscape or site related. Because of that, I'm going to turn the meeting over to Steve and Barry, but I'm certainly available should there be any questions on the building itself. I don't believe there were any specific questions or issues with regards to the building that I presented to you last meeting. Steve?
Thank you, Scott. My name is Steve Bradstreet with Edwards & Kelsey, civil engineers for the site design of the project. At the last meeting, the plans that we presented, we also presented a response to previous comments from staff and from the consultant engineers. I won't go through those. Those have been addressed on the plans. And then looking at the additional comments that were received, dated for tonight anyways, there were a few things that I'd like to note that were have been addressed. One is I met with Chief McGoldrick, actually met with him in his office, then we went out to the site. We found the Siamese fire connections, relocated them according to what he would like to see, and those have been shown on the plans. We went from a Siamese connection on the front of the building to a single 4-inch connection that's tucked up against the building. Per discussion with him in the field. We also discussed the fire access and what those fire access points should be. The one currently in front of the ranch, or beside the ranch coming into the parking lot, that will be retained. That's existing. If you go out there, you can see dying grass on top of the gravel, so you know it's there, and the fire chief wants that to be continued. There is an existing one also on the Sprague property. If you go out there, there are two telephone posts driven in the ground with a chain across. That is the fire chief's access to come down the side of the property and access the west end of the inn. And that has been in existence since the beginning of the first approval of the project or construction of the project. The other one that's existing, but we're making sure that everyone knows where it is the emergency access that goes between the new addition and the first cottage, the end cottage. That one will be slightly relocated. That's why it's been shown again. Because of the addition of the inn, it pushes it a little bit farther towards the cottage. And I walked that with the fire chief. That also you can see very plainly the grass is drying and dying on it. But that is a 12-foot gravel access way. Those are the items that I discussed with them. Also discussed the delineation, because that was a question that came from OST Associates, how these are delineated in the field. Chief McGoldrick chose not to request to have them physically delineated with posts or whatnot. One, they would get in the way. Two, he knows where they are, and he has his staff, his crew. Also, they know the location of them, and they do not need them delineated. So that's why you did not see anything on the plans in in reference to delineation. The other sort of major item, not major item, but additional item that was brought up was landscaping in the front of the addition. And I will go to the blow up so you can see it better. I will back up because here it is. The addition located here, there is planting shown on the plan on the east end. In this area here, there it is just grass, because there is a porch access here that has a detachable ramp for wheeling up large supplies and things that come from offloading. So there was, obviously, we didn't want to put any plantings there. The area that I think is in question is what was called the planter. My plan did not say what was in that planter. Barry Hosmer is here with me tonight, and I'd like him to sort of describe what he proposes in that planter that is sitting above ground. Barry?
Good evening. My name is Barry Hosmer. I'm the landscape architect on the project. The building extends out to this dotted line here so that there's actually a building underneath that planted area, and the resulting soil volume that we would have been able to obtain was only about 9 inches deep. So we felt that with freeze-thaw, we wouldn't be able to get anything that would grow in there that would be of a permanent nature. So what we're proposing to do is put in ornamental plant pots of some type. We haven't chosen exactly what they are going to be. And then we'll change by season what flowers or greens or whatnot might be in there. So it'll be a seasonally changing aesthetic situation. Thank you.
The other topic, which is not shown on my plans, but it was a plan that was included in your submittal, was the new lighting plan. The lighting plan did not show the property lines. We will show the property lines. And there was a question on whether or not it met the half a foot candle at the property line. Because the property lines weren't shown, you couldn't tell that. That plan is being revised and will be resubmitted. We have no no issue. That will be met. That criteria will be met with the final plan that will be approved by the town's engineer. The other item that was in Oss Associates was the parking requirements. I just wanted to touch base on that. The inn has received and is in your file an agreement with St. Bartholomew's Church in regards to additional parking for functions, and that was not incorporated, or at least not incorporated in my calculations, and I think that's what he brought out. He indicated that it was not consistent. We will revisit that and make it consistent so that the parking is not an issue. If you look from previous submissions, the 176 parking spaces that I believe I had in my report is consistent from even the submittal 18 months ago. That hasn't really changed. There's an inconsistency. I think there was one parking space that I did not count, and Oss picked up on it, but we wanted to let you know that with the new criteria or the new agreement with the church, that parking will be revisited so that we can give the town a final count on that. Other than that, the fire chief was happy with what I had proposed to him. I even sketched him a detail on the buildup and everything. He did not have an issue with it. Though I don't know if he had seen the plans and reviewed that in detail in this last submittal. I believe everything else that I see in Oss Associates' letter is minimal. They're detail-oriented, and we have no problem in addressing all those to the satisfaction of the town. With that, I'd like to answer any questions you have.
Well, before we answer any questions, I'd like to open the public hearing. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, public hearing is now opened. If anybody would like to speak about the Inn by the Sea, please come to the podium, state your name and address. Thank you. Seeing no one come forward, public hearing is closed. So, do you want to come back to the podium and we'll entertain questions from...
Okay, thank you.
Anybody have any questions? I have a question.
Yes.
There's been some discussion, and you've submitted an estimate, and the town, Bruce Smith, has concurred in the estimate about the cost of hooking up to the city sewer as opposed to septic. My question is severalfold. One is, have you experienced any problems at all with the septic system during the high season in the last 3 to 5 years?
I can't answer that. I don't know if Mike Zimmerman has that knowledge available, but I'd like to ask him to come up and hopefully he can address that.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Mike Zimmerman. I work for Olympia Development, which is the company that represents the owner of the property. There has been no problems with the septic system in the last 3 to 5 years. I think that was your question?
Yes.
In the height of the summer season, there's been no problems.
Okay, and the next question then is, given that you're going to expand the number of rooms and make some changes, are there any associated costs with upgrading the septic system?
Can I hand you back to Steve for that?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. No, there isn't. Al Frick, who is the designer and evaluator of the system, has indicated that the system has capacity for the additional rooms and the other internal changes that they're proposing within the inn to handle that. So there is not any existing capacity issues with the existing system.
The reason I ask is for some of us, it would certainly be preferable to hook up to the town
I understand that.
Sewer system. However, I can certainly understand you not wanting to spend, or them not wanting to spend, in excess of $300,000 to do it. So, other questions?
Barbara, relative to that issue, as I understand, the once a year there will be a review of the performance of the septic system, and it will be run through the town's code enforcement officer. Who ultimately has final review and oversight of whether or not it is appropriately functioning? Is that a town responsibility, or is that something that the applicant will be doing on an annual basis? I just want to make sure that I'm clear in reading that.
That question is addressed to me. I believe that the town is ultimately responsible for the decision making, but right now with Mark Sensi's letter and with Alfred's agreement into holding off on the testing that is currently being done, which does not seem to be appropriate at this time, that they will stand back and see how the septic system is operating. The owners of the inn will still have it tested and will be contracted, I am sure, with Alfred. Those tests will be either duplicated or checked by Mark Sensi and then sent to Bruce Smith for review, discussion, approval by the town.
And that's my interpretation of what I read. I just wanted to make sure that we were all clear
yes.
in that regard.
Okay.
Other questions?
Steve, the temporary paved entrance, it's not noted on the plans what the site distance is. It's a little farther east along 77. Is even though it's temporary and it's near the curve, do you foresee or do you need to follow up on site distance with a temporary paved entrance?
I don't believe I do. What works in your advantage is that while it's over here, the distance in this direction is 2,000 feet if it's 1,000. And in this direction, the curve in this direction goes upwards on the page as you're looking at it. So even as you go this way, it actually increases or has the potential of looking around that curve. If it was the opposite direction, that is not the case. If this was to go in this direction, that would not be the case. But the road is like this. As you go to the right with the driveway, that potentially either keeps the site distance the same or decreases it. Right now we had plus 800 feet, over 800 feet. Posted speed limit is 35. Rule of thumb, you need 350 feet of site distance. We have plenty. Even if we lost 100 feet, we'd still have 700 feet, which would be in excess of what is required.
Okay. Cross-section for that temporary paved drive, is that, I did not see that provided anywhere. What is the intent of what you're going to, I know it's short duration, but what is your intent of what that?
The intent is it would be 20 feet wide, which I believe is noted on the plans.
Yep.
It would be, you're correct. I don't believe there was a detail on there. We have a pavement detail for other sections. It would have 18 inches of gravel, 3 inches of pavement,
okay, so
which would be typical of a driveway entrance, parking lot, or the like.
Okay, so your intent it would be similar to what the other details would be.
That is correct. And then when it's the project is done, the pavement would be removed, some of the gravel would be removed, and be able to be replaced with a little bit additional loam on there, so we can establish a good sod.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I have a question regarding the parking. If you could explain to me the purpose of the church using that for parking and for
yes.
events.
What happens with the calculations of the available parking on site? There is 129 spaces, or I believe 130 by Ost's count, if I'm not mistaken. And the events that they have on site, if you have one parking space, that is enough for four patrons. And they wanted to be able to develop enough parking to be able to hold larger events. So what they are proposing to do is closing down the Seal Cove Room and the Audubon Room, I believe. That takes up some of those spaces and gives them to an outdoor party, let's say. So those spaces would be multiplied by four and added to it. Any of the additional spaces that they need that cannot be developed on site, they now have 40 spaces at the church that would allow for the additional patrons there. So that's why they are shuffling them from, or shuttling them, I should say, from off-site, just so they can entertain additional party guests. Or
so when it says up to 170?
76.
That is in addition to the guests that are staying at the inn?
Yeah.
It's in addition to?
Yes. Correct.
Okay. So you're assuming that the inn, in this case, you're assuming the inn is full?
With that scenario, which is a worst-case scenario, and that is not discussing any sort of shared parking, because many of the guests may be here for that event.
Sure.
But based on the inn is full with outside guests, that's what we're looking at, is 176 that we can entertain.
Okay. Now, does the planning board put a restriction on the number of guests that can go to a party at the inn?
Absolutely. There was an issue. When the inn received its original site plan approval, it had never received approval for outdoor events. And there were repeated complaints by some of the neighbors about the events. And so probably about a year before you joined the board, it came before the town. And the three key issues for approving outdoor functions at the inn were the limitations of the septic system, parking, and noise. The applicants came up with a creative system for dealing with noise. They could show that there was adequate capacity in the septic system to handle the events, and the real limiting factor was parking. And the town actually amended one of our existing off-site provisions to make it possible for the inn to legally contract with St. Bart's to use some of their parking for shuttle parking. But the inn never actually took advantage of that opportunity. They continued to, on paper, accommodate their outdoor event parking on site. With the addition, they're eating up whatever extra parking they had, and
okay.
Now they really do need to have that contracted off-site parking in order to sustain the number of guests. And the number of guests right now really is capped at the number of parking spaces they have available to handle all of that. One of the things that, I mean, the reality is that it's possible the inn might be booking events that have more than 176 guests. And this might be an opportunity to kind of open that up a little bit so that there wouldn't potentially be a violation in the future. But the inn doesn't have the space. The only other way to do that would be to acknowledge that some of the guests who are staying at the inn are probably also attending events. Need to keep in mind that the inn might have as many as three different unrelated events on a weekend. So you can't assume that all of the people who are staying there are going to all three events since they don't know each other. So it's possible that you could give them a credit, because the planning board does have authority under the off-street parking section to look at shared parking options. You could make a determination that, you know, 10 rooms actually could have shared parking spaces, and that would help them with the cap on the number of guests at their events. Or you could just leave it the way it is.
If I could just, Mr. Collins, if I could just address this issue. Speaking to the general manager of the inn today, she indicated that the inn was not planning on having any events over 150 people, because she didn't feel that the facilities of the inn would create a good experience for more than that number. I do agree with what Maureen is saying, that a significant number of the guests that come to these events also stay at the inn.
Right.
Not all of them, but a significant proportion. As Steve said earlier on, he needs to revisit some of his parking figures to accommodate the St. Bart's location as well. So within that calculations, we will be talking with Maureen about using some of the resident guest allocation for event of parking, as you just suggested.
You need to prove on paper that you have the parking that you need.
Yeah.
And you've submitted an agreement between you and St. Bart's that goes, I think, to the year 2012.
Correct.
So whether you actually use that parking for event parking is up to you.
Yeah.
On paper, it's available, and you can host up to 176 guests.
Okay. But just to assure Mr. Collins, we're not planning on hosting more than 150. 150 would be a maximum.
Maureen, is there a requirement that they would notify? Has that agreement changed at all?
The ordinance says that if you're relying on us on off-site parking, you have to have an agreement that is at least 3 years in duration. So if at any point they discontinued the agreement, they would technically be in violation of their site plan approval.
If they held those events.
Right.
In other words, they just said, we don't want to do events anymore. The agreement's being lost to them. There's no reason to have it.
Sorry, Maureen, one thing I wanted to address, that 176 figure that you come up with does assume the closure of the restaurant, which is something that I think with the renovated inn, we would like to maintain the restaurant at the same time as events, because we have in guests, and to maintain our AAA rating, we need to offer three meal services to those in guests who aren't attending the events, which is why I think we need to revisit some of the parking calculations, taking into account that we would not be closing the restaurant during those events.
If they need to be different from what's been presented tonight, I don't think that's something the planning board can treat as a condition.
I would agree.
Yeah.
So my guess is you can probably make what we have tonight work.
If you're happy to go with what we have tonight, then so are we.
Because this, it doesn't require you to close. I mean, the last time we dealt with outdoor events, the real struggle was to get up to the number of, give you a permit for the number of guests that, quite frankly, you were already hosting.
Yeah.
So we were trying to...
At events, not
right.
In.
Not right.
In.
So, the whole idea of closing portions of the inn to have an increase in the number of outside guests was brought forward by the owner. So the town never said you have to close the restaurant.
Okay.
We were working with you, and if you chose not to do that, I mean, if you want to tell the board tonight, we don't want to close the restaurant at all, we can alter the 176 number as part of tonight's approval.
I thought the St. Bart's agreement took care of that, though. Right? Am I missing something in this?
It doesn't. Because when they got their original approval for 76 guests, they actually had a surplus of parking on the site for the regular inn functions.
Okay.
So they had 25 extra spaces that they could then put towards outside events.
And that's being used up with the addition?
Even though they're adding the extra parking lot, it is being used up with a couple of different things.
I understand.
Just to clarify this, at least from my understanding, if you kept the restaurant open, then the number of guests that you could have at a function would be 164. Less the 12 for the...
It's 12 times 4. You don't have enough parking.
I don't have the figures. I don't have the...
12 spaces, it says.
12 spaces accommodates 4 guests. So you have to take 12 times 4 would be
48.
76, 176 minus 48 would be the total you would be allowed at outdoor events, which is well below the 150 goal.
Yeah. I think for the purposes of tonight, if we can use the existing 176, and if we decide to change any arrangements, then we would come back to you. Would that be acceptable?
Well, you've just said you want to have up to 150 guests, but you,
yeah.
Unless...
I would say that would be the...
percentage of them are staying at the inn.
I'd say that would be a maximum, be 150 guests, and it could be that with 150 guests, with that number of guests, it could be that we would have to close a meal service. I don't know, but with... I think 150 would be a rare occurrence.
Well, some of those guests... Now, Maureen, if you had 150 guests and say... 10 rooms were staying there because of the event.
If you give them 12 rooms, you make everything whole.
Correct.
Why don't you give them 12 rooms?
Yeah.
If you have 12 guests.
The thing too, Maureen, is 150 guests, it's very, very unlikely that everyone comes in a car, singly, isn't it?
Well, you know...
I think what we've
tried to do with our parking requirements, I mean, you can take the approach that you plan for Christmas Eve, you know, where you provide the amount of parking that you will need on the one day of the year when Rudy Giuliani is being hosted at the Inn by the Sea. Or you take what you think, not that he would ever be there, but, or you take a reasonable amount. And so our parking requirement assumes that there's one car for every guest room. So that assumes that, you know, people arriving together. It also assumes that there are one car for every four guests. Now,
right,
I think that is erring on the side of providing a little under what you need, but the other side of it is that you have to pave a lot more area for parking that's only going to be used, you know, six weekends out of the year. And I'm picking those numbers. So, yeah, I don't think the parking requirements are excessive.
Because they factor that in, Jack, I think is what you're saying. They factor in the fact that it's on average. It's not, it's like all traffic calculations.
What's factored in as far as
statistics?
Number of guests coming to an outside event? How many cars per guest?
One car per four guests.
One car per four guests, there too,
right.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the parking for the restaurant assumes that...
It's based on chairs. It's, I believe it's one space per four seats.
But that assumes that those 48 people are coming in from outside and aren't in guests?
Exactly.
Okay, which is, I mean, that's another, that's more room for...
Right, and we know what the whole shared parking concept is about. If you were to give, if you were to make a finding that you believe that you could take at least 12... take a maximum of 12 of the guest spaces,
mm-hmm.
12 of the guest room spaces, and assume that at least that number would be attending one event and give them 12 shared spaces, then they'd be back up to 176. So, or you could do a lesser amount if you want to get them back up to 150.
Right. I understand. Okay.
Well, in my own unknowledgeable opinion, I'd assume that a good number of the guests would be staying at the hotel. So we, you know, we could just say that 12. What, do we just have to put this in there as part of a condition then?
Yeah, I think if you're going to, I mean, right now the parking calculation is in the file. It's been done by Steve. He's off by one space, so his parking calculation is fine. But now that the applicant is saying that they still want to preserve 150 guests for outside events and they really don't want to ever close the restaurant, we may want to use this as an opportunity to make these numbers work in the approval. Otherwise, at some point, someone could complain and then the inn is back in the situation they were in a few years ago where they had booked all these events and they were not in compliance with the town rules.
So in these numbers, all we have to say is that the assumption is that a minimum of 12 rooms will be occupied by function guests.
And we can count those as 12 shared spaces. That there are 12 parking spaces that are being used by guests, by rooms, that are being shared with functions.
Yeah. I still leaves a question in my mind. Suppose you do have an outside function with 150 attendees or invitees, and most of them show up as duos or singles. How do you deal with the parking overflow situation then?
There's a lot of what ifs. Everyone could turn up on a motorbike.
Really, but far out stretch, I don't think. You know, they come as doubles and some singles. That's not terribly unusual.
For a wedding, that's pretty common.
It is common, yeah.
Yeah.
Coming as couples.
I think if we anticipated a large event, an upcoming large event in which we had major concerns, then maybe we'd talk to St. Bart's for a temporary increase in our 40 car allowance for that particular day. That would be a way forward.
Our concern based on that is that, you know, we don't have a lot of on-street parking and so forth when you have an overflow situation. So I'd like to have some assurance that you're ready to deal with that if it happens. And I think it will happen at some point.
Certainly, we could have a conversation with Simbats about that possibility arising and whether they would be flexible in terms of increasing that number of 40 spaces for such an occurrence, yes.
I might be able to help with some anecdotal information, since my son worked as a valet and busboy at the Inn by the Sea for 3 summers and shuttled many people's car over to St. Bart's, and there were times when they had many more cars than they anticipated, and an immediate call was made to the person that handles the facilities at St. Bart's, and they were given approval on the spot to park as many cars as they needed, providing that there wasn't a service that was going to be held.
Right.
The Inn was pretty sensitive to that and parked only in the back away from the church. And since my son would drive the cars down and then run back to the Inn, he would keep counting how many times he ran, because then he wouldn't have to work out the next day. So anecdotal information, family information, but I do know that it seemed to be handled quite nicely. And the tips were good, too.
Get to the important things now.
The important things, that's right.
And while we're on anecdotal information, I think Rudy Giuliani has stayed in the Inn in the past.
Paul, do you want to ask something?
A suggestion to the applicant, and I also may also say a thought for the board, knowing a little bit about this, if the applicant were to go through and determine through traffic and parking statistics, which there are plenty, my professional opinion is that your numbers would probably work out in your favor. And I'm wondering if it is in your favor from the standpoint of you can take allowances for shared parking. You can take allowances for a certain percentage of visitors and guests being at your facility, and there's reams of data that will support this and that you could use to support that. And I'm just wondering if instead of us guessing and making allowances that may or may not hit the mark, if it would be appropriate to do a more appropriate assessment of parking so that you could fine-tune and not guess whether 150 was the right number, but maybe it was something more, and then you could have a very real agreement with St. Bart's in terms of what your ultimate upper end might be. That's a suggestion that might benefit you in the long run.
We could certainly do an analysis of, say, the last 2 summers of the number of in-house guests that have attended events, the number of room bookings we've had associated with events. We'd be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And that would provide us with an accurate figure of how many spots were being taken, if that's what you're suggesting.
I am, and again, just my inkling is that it will benefit you in being able to do this, so that's why I'm suggesting that you consider that.
Is there anything that we can do as a board to still approve the plan tonight, but have a condition that so they don't have to wait another month? Maureen, on this topic?
Well, if
I agree with Paul's suggestion. I'm just trying to figure out a way that we can still, you know, let these guys.
I think if you want, I mean, what you could do is you could grant, if you want to move tonight, and I'm hearing you want to move tonight, you could grant approval tonight for either you could grant it for 150 with the 12 guests' rooms having shared spaces, and then leave it up to the applicant to elect to do more work and come back for an amendment if they so choose. Or you could table it and tell them they have to come back with that information. But you want to be careful that you're not delegating too much of your authority when you prepare conditions.
I was trying to stay away from conditions. We're talking about
right. Either
come back, applicant, or approve. And if you want to change or consider approval, come back with an amendment. I would pose that question to the applicant. Which direction would you? And that's not to say we will, but I want to know you.
Well, we'd certainly prefer approval tonight, sure, because this is obviously a major milestone in terms of getting the project out to bid and the time frame that we have, which is to break ground on October 7th.
Sure.
So we would certainly prefer approval tonight, and we would do everything we can to supply the board more information in the future, and we certainly have enjoyed a very good working relationship with this board.
Sure, and it seems if you're going to be closed for that period of time, I mean,
that's correct.
There's plenty of meetings to be set on an agenda for
now in May 2008, correct?
Well, I would hope you could find time to come in with it before you open the doors again.
Yeah.
So I thought that's the direction they would want to go, but I wanted to ask them.
I just wanted to clarify that.
Sure.
If the applicant is okay with getting approval for outdoor events at 150 guests, then you need to look at 6 guest rooms having shared parking, which is really a small amount.
Mm.
If you want to go back up to 176, then you're looking at 12 guest rooms.
We wouldn't be searching for any more than 150.
And again, if they wanted to revisit the numbers later, they're saying that's what they're looking for tonight.
6 is an extremely reasonable number given.
And just so I understand it, what we're doing in that calculation is we're assuming that of an event that 150 people are attending, 6 are coming from guest rooms to make the parking calculations work the way the applicant's proposing. Is that, do I have that clear?
Yes.
6 spaces, which is how many guests?
So 6 rooms.
Well,
6 rooms.
You're saying you're sharing the spaces. So if they're coming, if they're the guests, there's 1 space per room. And you're sharing 6 of those spaces. You get 1 room. If you're applying the space to a room, you get 4 guests if you're applying it to a function.
I'm very hesitant to start wandering into what-ifs. I mean, we have a set of criteria that based on statistical averages, and that forms the basis for our approval or disapproval. So if that's an assumption word that most of us are willing to make, given those statistical parameters, I'm willing to go with that and let the applicant take it from there in terms of numbers. If that's, you know, it seems to be acceptable to them.
It is.
Complies with the town's ordinance. And why are we looking too much further unless we're really anticipating big problems? I mean, if we come back after a summer and there's nothing but complaints about parking up and down 77 because St. Bart's is full, the parking lot's full, we're going to have to address it. I don't anticipate that. I mean, I live very close to this project, and that's not the issues that you're up there.
Well, I am uncomfortable about assuming that you have an event of 150 and the average car carries 4 people to the event. I don't think that's realistic.
Well,
except
I have a question also, and that is, welcome to water. I think that because you say you only want 150, you're only going to have 150, that doesn't mean somebody's not going to come along and say they're going to have 160 guests at a wedding, and you're going to turn them down. So I would recommend that if we have shared parking spaces, Paul, you're the expert in this area, instead of saying 6, that we assume that we have 10 or 12. So they could actually go up to 12 to make it 176 then? Why is that correct?
They're not asking for that part.
Whether they're asking for it or not, I'm saying what if there's a situation, because in this write-up that we have, we're looking at 160. Well, that's closing the restaurant and not having any shared parking. I'm just saying that maybe we ought to consider that there might be a slight number more. And if not, if everybody's happy with 6 and 6 share, that's fine. I look to you, Paul.
I can certainly say that wedding events, which are probably the biggest events that we hold, have shrunk over the past few years because of the costs of holding weddings.
You got 2, probably.
Yeah. Your average wedding size has gone maybe 8 years ago from 100. Down to about 60 to 70, your average wedding.
So you're happy with the 150, and we should write in this that we assume that 6 rooms are shared parking. Is that correct?
And okay. And the restaurant stays.
The restaurant stays open.
That's correct.
I think that's probably a very. That would be a terrible situation, I think, if you had an event and you closed the restaurant, because there are certainly going to be people at the inn who are not going to be attending the event, and they might well choose to eat in the restaurant. And to be told that you're paying X number of dollars for a room in a hotel that's supposed to be of high quality and not have a place to eat, I think is a mistake. So I personally wouldn't want to approve closing the restaurant.
How many cars can you get at the church?
We currently have a permission for 40.
But how many could you get there?
Hooten, do you know how many parking spots there are at the church?
There's a heck of a lot more than that, though.
Yeah. It's a big parking lot.
I don't know.
been in that parking lot many times, I never counted the spaces.
How'd you come up with the number 40, then?
That was just agreed with the Monsignor and the general manager of the inn. I wasn't involved in that negotiation.
I think the idea there was they needed that many, and with a little bit of cushion. They didn't ask for more, because at the time, they didn't need it.
I could...
You're saying you still don't need it, so maybe this is a moot point, and we should just...
Yeah. I just think you ask for more...
Do we need to make them part of it now?
Yeah.
Okay, that we make the conditions that the restaurant is open, and that we assume that six rooms are shared parking for events.
Do we say that Father, or he goes back to Father Henschel and gets more spaces with that agreement? Do we need to do that just because?
That's... No, we're saying not. I mean, I would rather have more rooms, and because right. Paul says that that's really modest, and not bother having a condition that they have to go back and get another agreement.
Okay. Right.
They need more parking. They're going to call them at the last minute and say, we need more parking. Right. So how do you want to do it? Peter's on the computer there, so let's tell him what to do. He already knows.
Well, just so I'm focusing on the right area, Maureen, it's approval. Finding of fact number four and approval number. Proposed finding of fact number four and approval number four. Is that right?
Oh, if it was me. I'd be working on the conditions of approval number four.
That's what I just did, but don't I need to amend finding of fact number four?
No, I usually use the findings of fact as a highlight, yes, you mentioned.
Our discussion. Well, that was my next question. Let me just read what I have so far, and I can, it says that the proposed approval condition would be that the previous conditions on holding outdoor events apply to this approval, subject to modification that the total number of guests for outside events is capped at 150 with the restaurant to remain open. Is that right?
And six guest rooms to be considered shared parking.
I mean, that's all. That's the applicant. Is there anything else you need in the fine?
That sounds great.
Anybody else have anything? I'd like to discuss one more change in our conditions, Peter. And I would like to add in under number three at the end by the sea no longer be required to perform quality water testing, but they water, are required.
Water quality testing, right?
They no longer be required to perform okay. Water quality testing. But be required to have a registered Maine soils scientist inspect the septic system at least once a year during the busy season and submit the findings to the town of Cape Elizabeth. The only thing I'd like to talk about is what happens if they're inadequate. And what happens, Maureen?
You can require that the inspection report be provided to the code enforcement officer.
Well, I said the findings be submitted right. To the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Yeah, to right. The CEO, right?
And he's the plumbing inspector. And right. If anyone provides him any information that a septic system is not functioning properly, he has authority under sewer rules to take care of that.
Okay.
He has obligation.
So instead of saying once a year during the busy season and submit the findings to the code enforcement officer, to Cape Elizabeth's code enforcement officer. Okay.
Any issues
make
with that
right.
I think that was part of the proposal from them anyway, wasn't it?
I would like to know conditions, I think. Jack?
I believe it's in their proposal, and we're approving that. I think they had annual September test in there.
September. Yeah, I understood that was part of the proposal anyway, that right. We would...
It's redundant.
I think we should make a condition for that to happen.
Okay, that's fine. But it is already in there. I think September 15th is a good date, because it will have already taken the fall. So
I think we should leave it in there.
And any problems will start to show up. We should get to the end of the summer there.
I think we should leave it in as a condition.
Where is that?
Does anybody disagree? So we should leave it in as a condition? Okay. All right, anything else?
Let me get
It's not currently a proposed condition.
Right, I'm just trying to get the exact language down. So, could you say it again?
You're the...
Oh, I don't mind.
You're the one with...
Examine or inspect? Trying to get the...
Inspection. That's more official.
Maureen, there's a number of changes that are going to be made to the plans per the town engineer's letter dated 7/11/07. Who will be reviewing those plans to ensure that they are adequate?
Usually what I do is the last condition requires the applicant to review, to revise all plans and submit them before they can do anything. And once he revises the plan, I send them back to the town engineer and he checks them.
So it goes back to OST?
Goes back to OST, that's...
And they review them?
And they review them, and I usually, at some point, they'll, what happens is, you know, there may be phone calls back and forth between the engineer and the applicant's engineer, and at some point I get an email from the town engineer saying he's now satisfied they've met the condition.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody have anything else?
Yes. The phrase you used was once a year during the busy season. I'd like to pin that down.
September 15.
By.
No, not by.
On or about.
On September 15th?
Yeah, on or about.
On or about.
Hey, anything else? We have a motion for the board.
Not yet.
Okay. Yeah, wait a minute.
Chair, I have a motion for the board to consider.
Thank you.
I propose that we make the following findings of fact. The Inn by the Sea is proposing an expansion that will add 15 guest rooms, parking, a utility shed, and landscaping and miscellaneous renovations to the Inn by the Sea located at 40 Bowery Beach Road, which requires review under Section 19-9 site plan regulations. Number two, the town engineer has identified several construction details which should be addressed to avoid conflicts during construction. Three, the site plan regulations restrict light levels to no more than, is that five or 0.5?
0.5
foot candles at the property line. Four, the planning board has previously decided on conditions that are needed to hold outdoor fence. Five, the applicant will be removing most of the landscaping in front of the property and should show those areas, how those areas will be revegetated. Six, the application substantially complies with Section 19-9 site plan regulations. That be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Inn by the Sea to add 15 guest rooms, parking, a utility shed, landscaping, and miscellaneous renovations to Inn by the Sea located at 40 Bowery Beach Road be approved subject to the following conditions. One, that the plans be revised per the town engineer's letter dated July 11th, 2007. Two, that additional foot candle lighting information be provided for the area west of the new parking lot, demonstrated that the lighting level is less than 0.5 foot candles at the property line. Three, that the Inn by the Sea no longer be required to perform water quality testing, but shall be required to have a Maine registered soil scientist inspect the septic system once a year on or about September 15th, and submit the results of this inspection to the Town of Cape Elizabeth Code Enforcement Officer. Four, that the previous conditions on holding outdoor events apply to this approval, subject to modification that the total number of guests for outside events is capped at 150 with the restaurant to remain open and six guest rooms to be considered shared parking spaces. Five, that a landscaping plan for the area between the addition and the sidewalk be provided, and six, that there'll be no alteration of the plan or issuance of a building permit until the plans have been revised to reflect the above conditions.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous, and Peter, thank you very much.
No problem.
Well done.
Thank you very much.
Once they get these down, we'll consider the Ocean House Child Development Center site plan, and we're looking at the completeness tonight. And the public hearing. Before we introduce the applicants, the town planner has a disclosure to make.
I just need to disclose that my daughter is a student at the Ocean House Child Development Center, and I have brought this issue before the board and before the town manager, and offered, and at the town manager's direction, the board does have the option of electing to have a substitute planner review the application, but they're not required to do so.
And I would like to add that the planning board was unanimous in its decision that Maureen would be completely impartial and fair and be able to review the project very, very well. We did not allow her to step down.
Okay, I'm Laurie Grant, and this is Peggy Littlefield, and we own and operate Ocean House Child Development Center. We're currently located at the Cape Elizabeth United Methodist Church and provide care for 32 children. We're proposing to convert the former Maxwell's Farm Market, located at 185 Spurwink Ave, which is just off Route 77, into a child care facility to move our center to. We've just celebrated our fifth birthday at Ocean House, and our lease is up with the Cape Elizabeth United Methodist Church at the end of August. We have a large waiting list for our program and a demand for a pre-K and school-age program. We'd like to locate our state of Maine licensed child care facility in the former market. We'll be using all the existing building, existing parking lot, existing entrances and exits to the site, existing lighting, landscape, and the sign, pretty much with the exception of changing the wording of the sign. We will be only making minimal changes, adding a couple of windows, and appropriate fencing for the play areas. Immediately, we will convert the first floor of the building to classrooms, which will provide space to care for 47 children. And then, as enrollment increases, we'll convert the daylight basement space to classroom space, as well as increasing the play area size from 3,925 square feet to 4,585 square feet, which will be enough for 60 children. We just indicated the play areas on the plan here. Right now, we're applying with the state for a child care license for up to 47 children, and as we're able and enrollment increases, we'll apply for a state of Maine license for up to 60 children.
Thank you. We've scheduled a public hearing for this evening, so please have any questions and go on. I'd like to, excuse me. Oh, we have to deem the, sorry, getting ahead of myself here. We have to deem whether or not the application is complete. Anybody have any questions about that?
Yeah, actually I do. I don't know what the requirements are. I know you talked in here about the requirements for how many square feet of outdoor play space for the kids.
Yes.
Is the same requirement levied by the state? Or
it is. It's the same. It's for the play area space outside. It's 75 square feet per child.
Inside?
No, outside. Oh, inside, I'm sorry. It's
What's the inside requirement?
35 square feet per child.
Is that the same for preschools and just for grades 1, 2, and 3?
It is in a child care capacity, not public school, because I don't think they have guidelines like that. I'm not sure. But
I mean, you're going to up to grades 3, and I was wondering whether going beyond K has a different set of requirements.
Actually, it'd probably be less, I would think. I don't know, but I know that it's the same. It is 30, because I actually was a director of a school-age child care program for a number of years. as well, so. So I'm familiar with those guidelines.
Any questions about compliance? Motion for the board to entertain them, please. Regarding completeness.
Yes, but if you use the other motion that's there and just substitute complete or incomplete.
I move that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Laurie Grant and Peggy Littlefield for site plan review and conditional use permit to expand the Ocean House Child Development Center from 32 to 60 children and relocate the daycare facility from the Methodist Church located at 280 Ocean House Road to the former Maxwell's Farm Market located at 185 Spurwink Avenue be deemed complete.
I'll second.
All in favor? Okay, now we'll open the public hearing. Anybody who would like to come forward to speak about this project, please do so. State your name and address also. Seeing no one step forward, we'll close the public hearing and open this up to questions from the board. I have a question, Maureen, for you. Do Laurie and Peggy have to come back here to increase to 60 children because of the playground, or do they need to come back to the interior space also?
They need to come back for whatever they don't get approval for tonight. So if you approve, if they had enough space for 60 children and they only had an approval for 47, they would still need to come back to the planning board to get approval for more than 47 children. So the way this was structured, and it's what we've usually advised most applicants to do, is to look to the future, plan ahead, potentially not have to return to the board too many times. But what this applicant is asking for is a conditional approval for 47 now. Actually, it would be up to 60 now. And the understanding is they have provided all the information they need for 47, and that when they, if they expanded to 60, they would have to expand their fenced-in play area by, I forget how many feet.
So the only question about expanding at this point would be the play area. They could expand to 60 children and renovate the inside, coming back to us again.
No,
as we approve up to 60.
We regulate the use. So they could not expand to 60 unless you grant them approval for that.
So if we granted them approval for 60 tonight, they would have to then fence in enough play area for 60 children.
Well, the proposed condition would be that they operated at 47, and then when they decide to expand to 60, at that point they would need to also expand the play area.
And get an addition, and get an increase.
And get the license from the state. That's right.
But wait a minute. It's the state license that's driving the increase in the play area.
Actually, it's not, because when the town wrote, we rewrote our own daycare standards. Actually, it was a long time ago now. But we put the square footage requirement in that is the same state as the state at that time.
So we actually.
It's in our ordinance.
Approvals,
yeah, in our home daycare standards, it says you have to. There's several things in there. It says, you know, you can't be open on Sundays, and you can't be open any you know 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. and you have to have a safe area to drop off and pick up kids, and you have to have 75 square feet of play area per child.
Oh, well, wait, that's actually in here.
Right.
Yes.
So they don't have to come back to us again.
They wouldn't have to come back to you if you approve it that way.
Well, I highly recommend we approve it that way. Sorry, I missed
it. The chair should be.
Here I am, thinking that. The chair should be saying right.
So, Barbara, do you have any more questions of the applicant?
No. Anybody else? Motion for the board to consider.
Motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, Laurie Grant, Peggy Littlefield are requesting site plan review to expand the Ocean House Child Development Center from 32 to 60 children
and relocate the daycare facility from the Methodist Church located at 280 Ocean House Road to the former Maxwell's Farm Market located at 185 Spurwink Ave, which requires review under Section 19-9, site plan regulations in Section 19-5-5 conditional use standards. Two, the applicants are seeking approval to expand from 32 to 47 children with long-term expansion to 60 children. Three, the daycare facility will be located in a developed site which has previously received site plan approval and minimal site changes are proposed. Four, the application substantially complies with Section 19-9 site plan regulations and Section 19-5-5 conditional use standards. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Laurie Grant and Peggy Littlefield for site plan review and a conditional use permit to expand the Ocean House Child Development Center from 32 to 60 children and relocate the daycare facility from the Methodist Church located at 280 Ocean House Road to the former Maxwell's Farm Market located at 185 Spurwink Ave be approved, subject to the following condition: that prior to the expansion of the daycare facility from 47 to 60 children, a state license for 60 children be obtained and the fenced-in play area be increased to a minimum of 75 square feet per child.
I'll second. All in favor? Unanimous.
Barbara, how about a five-minute break?
All right, we've just had a request for a short break from a planning board member, so we'll take about a four-minute break.
Starting now.
Did you know how to do the bike?
Is that you?
Yeah, I put that in.
Requesting a site plan review to convert the existing gas and service station. Would you please introduce the project to us?
Certainly.
Greg Jones. Thank you.
My name is Greg Jones, and while raising our three children, my wife and I used a famous phrase, quote, many times, you cannot direct the wind, but you can adjust the sails. I'm here tonight to adjust the sails of the vessel Jonesy Service Center, because it's blowing in a direction we don't want it to go. To that end, we're undertaking the biggest change in our 59-year history, a necessary change to do away with automotive service and replace it with a convenience store with a sandwich shop. I want to commit to the town as a necessary change, something I did not come about easily or quickly. And while I regret it in many respects, I find it ultimately necessary. To that end, I want to introduce Ron St. Pierre, who is a project manager who handles this these kinds of dealings for my distributor, who is R.H. Foster. R.H. Foster Energy is out of Hamden and has been my distributor for 17 years now. And Ron handles all their C-store buildings and transitions. He's worked quite a bit to this point with town staff to try to keep me on a tight schedule that will minimize the disruption to the business itself and to the employees who will be impacted. So I'd like to introduce Ron St. Pierre.
First off, we're here tonight to review the plan for completeness.
Yes.
Maureen's been a tremendous help in this project. As Greg stated, he wants to convert his now service station to a convenience store. That encompasses adding on approximately 760 square feet to his existing building. And so in reviewing the plan for completeness, Maureen had several issues that we are in a position to mitigate this evening. The first of those issues was a deed to the property, and Greg has provided a deed to the property, which I will provide to Maureen and to the planning board. The second issue was the plans do not provide the names of property owners across the street. We have the property owners that are abutting Greg on one side. We have since then gone to your website and diligently probably listed more than what is required as far as the abutters, but we also did the ones on the diagonal across from Greg as well as the one directly across from him. The third issue was that we had originally stated that we would close in both curb cuts, entrances. After reviewing traffic patterns and how Greg's tanker, when it offloads, exits the site, and also the fact that the state is looking at doing something with this intersection and it's not ultimately known what they will do, we have chosen to leave pretty much, if you look on your plan, you will see the existing grassed vegetated island that is out in front of the location today. And what we have chosen to do is leave this entrance alone until we find out what the state is going to do, and they at that time may dictate what happens with that entrance. This entrance here, and you can see the current, we are proposing to lessen by 13 feet. This will go from basically, actually it's 14 feet. It'll go from approximately 50 feet across down to 36. So you can see where the existing curb cut is, and our new curb cut extends, or our grassed island extends and eliminates two parking spaces in the service station parking lot and becomes green space for trees out front and shrubs and flowers, as well as a sidewalk in front of the location, which will be the only sidewalk on that side of the street in town. And we would hope that at some given point, Cape Elizabeth would choose to put a crossing lane across the street, pretty much as they have done down past this intersection. The next issue that Maureen brought to our attention, and it's one that we knew existed.
Chairman. Madam Chair. We're on for completeness on this project tonight. And I'm
right.
Go ahead.
Oh.
I'm hearing more sort of substantive, or are we just looking at the changes?
Well, I think Mr. St. Pierre was talking about meeting the conditions that Maureen said were incomplete the last time.
Right.
I see.
Remember
that's what I was addressing her, saying that we hadn't changed the curb cuts, and we have not changed this one, but we have.
Okay.
Change that one.
I'm looking at this as more of a substantive presentation.
Right. But no, it's not meant to be.
And you'll probably have to rehash the same issue when we
right.
get to the public hearing. As long as you're
then the next issue that you brought to our attention is the existing setbacks. And we are aware that the existing corner of Greg's building is within the setback. We do not propose to change that. We are going to leave that. We're actually intending to use the three walls of Greg's existing structure. So we would assume that since we are using the three walls of his existing structure, that that would be grandfathered, even though it is within the setback. It's been there for 30 years or so. We do not intend to change it or encroach upon the setback anymore. We have requested a waiver from providing utility information in the sense we intend to use city water. Existing water line coming into the location, and Greg's current sewer system is a gravity fed system that he connects onto right here and runs down right here to the main sewer system. So that's why we're requesting a waiver. We are not intending to add additional sewer or whatever, but use the existing that already is there. Location of lighting. On the plan, on the building, the only lighting that we're proposing for this site, because there are site lights on the street itself that light this location, all we're looking at is lighting on the building itself, and these are downcast 200-watt lights, which equate to a zero spillover as far as site lighting. And the locations are shown, and like I said, these are all strictly 200-watt, and they're on the light and for the safety of the customer. So all lights are to be a downcast 200-watt metal halide. The other and last item of completion was that we were requesting and are requesting a waiver from providing Greg's financial records.
I'd like to make a comment about that if nobody else, just in terms of completeness. In case Mr. Jones doesn't understand, you don't submit that to us. We don't look at your financial records. That would go, you either get a letter from a bank saying that they will provide your financing and that you're capable of repaying whatever loan there is, or you deal with the town manager and send something to him. And I hope that you're going to remove that waiver.
Sure.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm sorry, yeah. Is that it? What was that?
We will not request a waiver for the financial. He will provide either a letter from his bank or a letter to the town manager.
Yeah, we don't see that.
We don't see anything.
Okay.
It's not part of the public.
Okay. And that's fine. So at this point, we would request that you would deem our application complete so that we could come back to your next meeting for public hearing and substantive review.
Do we have any questions about completeness, or do I have a motion for the board to consider?
I have some questions for Maureen. Maureen, are you looking for photometrics? Is that what you're... So we should get that, even though they're...
Well, I'm looking for the exact language here for you. When you go to make a vote on whether or not to grant, excuse me, site plan review, under standard... Somewhere in here. Under M, exterior lighting, you need to make a finding. I'm on page 207 of the zoning ordinance. The second paragraph under M, exterior lighting, says direct or indirect illumination shall not exceed 0.5-foot candles at the lot line or upon abutting residential properties.
And how do you determine that?
You can't make a finding on that if you don't have the information.
That, yeah.
You could make a finding, it's just not, there's no basis for the finding.
No, these aren't in here because we're trying to drive up expense or make you get tests. I mean, we have criteria we have to follow, and that's the point of the exercise. And where we can obtain the information and the evidence without making you do certain things, we're more than happy to consider waivers, but where there's just no way.
Okay.
I don't see a way to do that. Maybe, and I'm not an engineer.
I can provide that, but I'll assure you that it's zero at the...
That's
but
fine.
I can provide it.
Yeah, it's easy to...
And I will provide it.
Okay.
The other question, Maureen, is on the utility information. We're just basically asking for it to be shown on the plan. Is that correct?
Yes, we're asking it to be shown on the plan, and quite frankly, the town engineer was having some difficulty reviewing these plans. There's an indication of a force main, and we weren't sure where that was going and if that applied, and he was concerned that we need to see where the utilities are. And, you know, every time you work on a tight site, there's less and less room for error. I understand that most of the site is existing, but having worked with the town engineer, he often finds conflicts when he starts getting that kind of information.
What we do know is that Greg is hooked to a gravity feed sewer that's existing. And I asked Greg about this because Maureen brought it up, because this, the only information we had was from a past survey originally of this force main, And my understanding that this is not a force main that's in effect, that it's not there, that this was a proposed easement from
United Methodist Church.
United Methodist Church, so that in the future, should they choose to run the 2-inch line for the force main up through, that Greg provided this easement back when he did his last renovation, which was
1990.
But to this date, the force main has not been installed. That's my understanding. And it shows on the plan where Greg is, nothing is tied in, and it, like I said, some of the things from back in 1990 were sketchy, and we did have a surveyor come down and do the lot for things that Oast Engineering had asked for. And we have shown where the existing sewer comes out of the building and travels, and that is the one we were looking to tie to.
By gravity.
Do you show water on this plan?
No. The water main, and I looked at it tonight, is right out here at Road and comes in the same general area, and I will show it on a future stamp plan. I probably have to go to utilities individual to get that.
Yeah, I think that was one of the town engineer's concerns, that the existing locations of water and electrical service should be added to the plan, so that those locations are available for any situation.
What I would look for, not to interrupt you, what I'd look for is a letter from your head of public works stating that the water service that is connected today would be adequate to support what Greg is.
That's not what we're talking about.
Yeah, and he couldn't provide that, the public works department. The adequacy of public water is something that would be provided by the Portland Water District.
It's Portland Water District?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Town doesn't have
a... We want the existing locations.
Yeah, but you do need to show them.
Water and electrical mark on your plans.
So I think, Maureen, if I'm hearing the rest of the board members, we're suggesting that the applicant not request a waiver for showing the utilities on the site plan.
That's right.
And that they do show all utilities, all existing. And you have information showing that that force main is related to the church, either an easement document or something in writing, I think that'd be helpful.
Based on these two items, I'd ask that the board at least consider it as a substantive complete, and these two items be provided.
Maureen, what are your thoughts on that? I'm kind of on the fence here, and I'm not, again, trying to hold anything up for the sake of...
I'll be pretty upfront. I don't think this is a complete application.
Okay.
There is information that is missing that is critical to review. You know, maybe it's 75% there, but it needs to be a lot closer than, in my opinion, to be deemed complete. Utilities, side setbacks, financial capability, you know, all of the important information. I mean, it's all important information, but this is essential information to being able to do a level of completeness review, and I think it is appropriate that it be all there in order for the town engineer and for us to deem it.
The site setbacks are shown, and the building is shown on both things as proposed and existing. Within the site setback, it's an existing condition, and it is shown on the plan specifically.
I think there is a fair amount of information that is not here that needs to be addressed.
There is, Maureen, if we judge this incomplete and have them come back again, work very hard with you to make sure every I is dotted and every T is crossed, is it possible to schedule the public hearing for next time or not? Mm. Or is that not a very good idea?
Well, typically, I mean, the ordinance says you're not supposed to schedule a public hearing until the application is deemed complete. And the reason you do that is because the public hearing is an opportunity for the public to tell you what they think. And the public often feels cheated of that opportunity if they don't have a full application for them to review and base their comments upon. So, I mean, there have been a few times when you have relied on the applicant to come forward with a complete application and schedule the public hearing, and then said, if you don't get it deemed complete, we're not going to do it.
Those tend to be rather compact projects, or small issues or amendments, or simple changes, or relatively non-controversial.
I will say I have, I've received an inquiry about this, so there's at least one person who's interested.
This is a fairly substantial change to a big part of the center of town. And again, I'm not holding this up just for the sake of holding it up, but I'm more of a mind of Paul's that, you know, I just feel like we don't have enough here. And I'm reluctant to kick it over just for the sake of kicking it over. And I'm not comfortable setting it down for a hearing where we need some time to take a look at some of this stuff. So I guess there were motion to be proposed for incompleteness, that's probably where I'd be going right now. I mean, there's seven of us here.
What's the part that makes you most uncomfortable, Peter?
Liz, I don't feel like the town engineer has had enough time to review a complete application to give us feedback on the incomplete items. I mean, and that's a fair question. Jim, let me try to be a little more specific.
Could I try to clarify something for my own benefit? The only thing that I see as of right now that we have are the photometrics from the 200-watt metal halides on the building, the location of the water, the existing water and sewer lines that we intend to use, and a letter from the City of Portland saying that they can handle our respective flows. The other thing is...
Water. Portland Water Department? District. Portland Water District.
Right, the Portland Water District, excuse me.
That's not the City of Portland.
Oh, okay, Portland Water
They're their own little entity.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
And Greg is to provide a copy of the easement for the forced water main, and a letter...
Forced sewer main,
excuse me. And a letter to the town manager from his bank or whatever, or... to the board on financial. Those are the items that I look at. The most substantial of those, I would think, is the Portland Water District and showing where the current sewer lines are.
I think we need electrical service on the plans too, as well, don't we? I didn't see any poles noted.
I think you have to read the town engineer's letter very carefully and make sure you understand every point that's in there, because there are other points we haven't covered at all here that deserve consideration by you as far as the application.
What points would those be?
Well, catch basins, that was one up above.
Oh, those were all addressed previously. What happened is, last month, we came for the set of plans to Maureen. She gave them to Oast Engineering. They came back with that original set of items, and we addressed what we thought were all those items. In turn, we came back this month with a revised set of plans to Maureen, and out of that revised set of plans that Oast reviewed, we came out with these items that I've just addressed this evening. No. So we've addressed all these other items.
The letter I'm looking at from Oast is dated July 11, which is just last week.
Now there's a July.
July 11.
Mm-hmm. You have a copy of the Oast July 11th?
I have a June 11th. I have a July 17th.
But it also does say in the number 2 that the following comments presented in this letter relate to design details and other elements of the plan which may be beyond the completeness level.
And that's common. We do sometimes get from the town engineer some design details, and that's appropriate. Again, given the size and the nature of the application, even having two or three items not provided, again, in my opinion, deem this application not to be complete. While they may be information that may be readily obtainable, can be obtained quickly, that's great, but if it's not there and it's not available for us to review, the town planner to review, the town engineer to review, then I go back to my original statement that I don't think this application is complete.
I guess I'd circle back to the question I started this with. Maureen, what are your thoughts on some of these issues? I mean, we've had two letters from OSA Associates. We've had the presentation by the applicant on the issues he feels are left. And do you feel, based on what you have in PDF Plus, what they've provided tonight, the town staff can give us enough feedback to hold a public hearing for... question calls for a yes or no?
No.
Can you explain that a little bit?
Well, I mean, I think we're all very sympathetic that it's a local businessman who wants to move forward as quickly and expeditiously as possible. But if we set that issue aside,
right,
I think we'd all agree that there are still a lot of information missing from the plans. You know, I hate having to say it, but I mean, there's a lot of confusion just figuring out where the boundary lines are in the plans, because the survey isn't stamped. There are lines that say, there are notes on there that say to be acquired, when I had to explain to the town engineer, because I know the site, that that in fact is owned and has been owned by the property owner. So I really think the plans need to be overhauled. They need to be up to date. Not understanding that the sewer force main is actually an easement should have been clearly identified as part of the survey.
I would think.
So,
keep going.
You know, there's, I understand that the existing building is shown on the plan, but there also is a line that says 30-foot setback all the way around there. Mm. And what the ordinance says is show existing setbacks. Mm. And the existing setback from that corner to the property line is approximately 6 feet, which is pretty close.
Mm. The setbacks on that side are 15 feet. As shown on the stamped plan, it shows a 15-foot setback, shows that in there. On the plan that you
but
have
before
you...
I think, Ron, what we're looking for is, in that corner,
right,
there should be an actual dimension on there that shows, because, you know, being an engineer, I've always been, you know, the engineers say, you don't just slap a scale on the plan and figure out what it is. You actually show a dimension. So you show a dimension from
it
that
is
tight
nine
corner.
Feet. It is 9 feet from the line to
right
here and 6 feet
and
from
and
here.
That's not on the plans right now.
And I did scale it out here, or I did actually plot it to see where it was. But in the last plan, you mentioned the boundary lines, but in the stamp plan that was provided, all of that cursory information that you brought forward was removed with our stamp plan in order to clean it up as requested by OSA on the last letter that I received. So this again is the stamp plan that we provided for this time, and it shows the complete boundary line.
Is the plan stamped by a surveyor or by an engineer?
An engineer.
Right. So there's a difference between the qualifications that a surveyor has for determining property ownership and an engineer for designing sites.
And I think it needs the regulations say surveyor, correct?
And the thing is, you know, sometimes we're able to get past without that, but
the
kind of confusion about the sewer force main is exactly the kind of reason you get a stamped survey from a surveyor.
That's a pretty big item, among others. Plus the water, in and out.
Maureen, we were provided two sets of plans. So one was the original set, and the second set was one that reflected
the changes from the first notes from OST.
Right, but the second set of plans doesn't replace the first set of plans.
It does.
Supplements.
Okay. Supplements, all right.
I have a motion for the board.
You beat me to it. Go ahead.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Grain Jones for site plan review to convert Jonesy's, an existing gas service station located at 298 Ocean House Road, to a gas station / convenience store, be deemed incomplete.
I'll second that motion. Do we have any discussion on it?
I'm in support of the completeness, as much as I would prefer not to be, because I'd like to see this move along, but I think we have the integrity of the public hearing to keep in mind, and there is a lot of detail that I think members of the public need to see on this plan that OSP is asking for that isn't on there. And as a major piece of property at the intersection of what is essentially our town center, we really need this to be completely buttoned up. So I'm in support of the motion.
I would agree with those comments.
I have to say that I'm bummed. I wanted to move forward too, but I have to agree with what you're saying.
Okay, so
I'm all set.
Okay. All in favor? The motion? Opposed? Sorry.
Maureen, procedurally, where does the applicant go from here? That's right. In the regs, I've never been able to figure that out clearly.
Yeah, the applicant should return to his plans, take all the information that's been provided on what's not complete, and revise the plans and resubmit again.
The merits of the project have not been voted on. This is not a denial.
What I would recommend is to make sure that everything that you need to do is correct and comes to us next month. Unfortunately, we just need to do what we need to do. We really support local businessmen, and we really want things to be done correctly. So I'm very sorry for all the board members, but we have to do this. Thank you. Right. And the last project that we have tonight is Canyon Creek Development LLC requesting site plan review in elder care facility. And we'll review the project for completeness.
That's just what I was looking at. I'm going through this. This can't be done.
Would you please introduce yourselves and introduce the project? Thank you.
Absolutely. Good evening, ma'am and the board. My name is Stephen Bay. My colleague here, Albert Castaneda, are here as the applicant and the representative for Canyon Creek Development. Our firm is based out of Salem, Oregon. And as an introduction, Canyon Creek Development is actually the acquisition and development wheel for SunWest Management. And SunWest Management is essentially the senior housing group who manages the daily operations for all of our senior housing projects. Essentially, upon completion today, we'd like to propose to you our senior housing project on Scott Dyer Road, which was formerly known as the Cape Elizabeth, the Viking Home. We will be proposing renovation, demolition, and expansion of the existing building. Before we step down, Albert here, my colleague, would like to let you know about one of our activities that's going on in a couple of weeks here.
Thank you, Board. My name is Albert Castaneda, and I'm a Canyon Creek employee. We had a meeting today with the entire team. I think we had about six or seven of us out there, met with the chief, fire chief, to go over getting the building ready to house somewhere between 8 and 10 athletes of varying disabilities for the race here in a few weeks. And it was very encouraging figuring out meals and what we'd have to do for fire safety and just looking at some of the site conditions as far as they relate to fire and fire life safety. So we did have that today. I just thought that'd be a good little nugget that we were moving forward and trying to actively become part of the community well before that building was fully operational.
Good evening.
My name's Chris DiMatteo with Sebago Technics, and I hear David Schaefer from Morris. Willie Morris is the architect. He's here tonight as well. I'm just going to briefly go over the site plan here, and then if the board is interested, chair is interested, David can go over some of the architectural components. Just quickly, the site plan, north is up here. We have the Willow Brook along this side here, Scott Dyer Road here. These are the two existing entrances. Essentially, the existing conditions, this plan shows in two different greens, the wetlands, the RP2 and the RP1 zones, and the upland is the green here. Existing vegetation line along this side, we have a pretty substantial wooded buffer, a wooded woodland edge. It would actually a substantial buffer. Existing buildings here. Essentially, the proposal is to remove this existing wing here that has 60 nursing home beds, along with maintaining this building here with the 55, it would be increased to a total of 95 units. Maintaining the 55 beds and an additional 40 senior independent living in this wing here. In terms of improvements, the proposal shows a new connection between the parking lots here. In terms of landscape, we've focused on essentially adding to the buffer, adding to the accent of the building. In terms of adding to the visual buffer from the abutters, we've actually created more planting opportunities within the parking area here, kind of bulging that out to kind of help, adding some here to help with the views into the parking area. We relocated a dumpster location existing here to the rear of the property here. We've actually consolidated the propane tanks to this area here. I think, again, just a note of clarification, this is the orange line here is the property line, 5 acres, 5 acre site. We're extending water and sewer and electric. We have that, we're gonna maintain the existing taps, just extending that onto the property into the new building. The actual pavement with regard to with the exception of areas where there is no pavement, we're going to rebuild those full reconstruction. The rest of it, unless it's damaged during construction, is going to receive just a seal coat and then just the restriped. So with that, I was wondering, is the board interested in hearing some more about the architecture?
Do you want to hear about the architecture, or you just want to go on to voting on the completeness of this?
Yeah, that's the completeness.
Completeness.
Well, and I don't think we can take that at this point, can we? No.
Does anybody have any questions about completeness? We have a motion for the board to consider.
I have a motion. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Canyon Creek LLC for a site plan review of the Crescent Beach Retirement and Assisted Living Community, including 55 assisted living beds and 40 elder care apartments located at 126 Scott Dyer Road, be deemed complete.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? A public hearing will be scheduled for the next meeting. And is there anybody else who has any questions they want to ask at this point of the applicant before, in terms of design or anything else?
We haven't voted on the public hearing.
Vote on the public hearing.
Well, you don't want to vote on the public hearing until you want to be done with the project for tonight. And I just wanted to point out that the applicant's architect is here from outside of New England, in case you want to hear from him tonight.
I think we should hear from him tonight, then.
I think we should definitely hear from him tonight.
When the architect comes up, could you please go a little bit into the, I had a little trouble with the plans, figuring out the, I'm assuming that each unit has a sitting room and a bedroom, but I can't tell for sure. So if you could sort of make that clear in the independent living units.
I certainly can. I can address that question first. The existing portion of the building, the 55 assisted living units, we're not changing. At least the intent is not to change.
Can you just identify yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry. Could you identify yourself, please?
I'm sorry. David Schaefer from William Morris Architects. I'm the project manager for the firm.
Thank you.
In the independent living portion, there's going to be a mix of studios, one bedroom, and two bedroom units.
Oh, okay.
David, can you pick up the plan that the fellow from Sebago Technics had and show me on that plan where those existing units are?
The existing units.
I don't know the facility that well.
The existing units are in this two-story portion of the building here. The one-story skilled nursing facility that occupies just about the same footprint here is being demolished to accommodate this building that's from this line over.
Okay, thank you very much.
And this will be two stories. It'll be a wood frame structure. And the intent is to mimic the aesthetic and materials that are found on the existing AL building to remain. AL being assisted living.
Do you just want to show us the, well, we have the exterior, talk a little bit about the materials on the exterior.
Certainly. The this portion here to the right of my hand, this is the existing AL building. This is what we are creating that's new. The existing building is a mix of siding and brick, and we'll be maintaining that. We'll be using a fiber cement siding and brick. This is the side of the existing building that faces the Willow Brook. As you can see, it's a mix of siding and brick, and we're trying to mimic that same modulation of brick and siding throughout our new facades.
Questions?
Talked about a mix of studios, one and two bedrooms. Could you just go through what is that mix currently proposed?
The mix, I don't have the numbers in front of me. The mix is, I believe, five studios, 11, it's five studios. That's a very good question. I'll have to check on that. But it's five studios and a mix of one bedroom and two bedroom, primarily with the units being one bedroom.
Do you know if there's a heavier weighting to one or two bedrooms? Do you know if it's a greater number of two bedrooms?
It is a greater number of one bedroom units.
Thank you.
Other questions?
No, I noticed there have been some pleasing changes made to the exterior facade from what we saw in some of the original sketches. Yeah.
Taking into account some of our feedback, I think, right? Yeah.
Anybody have anything else? All right. We should schedule a sidewalk. Everybody think we should have a sidewalk? Some people aren't familiar with it. I'm more familiar with this property than I'd ever want to be. But.
I'd very much appreciate a sidewalk. Yeah, I'm not familiar with it.
Yeah. We put your name in on it.
Thank you very much.
It's getting late.
Oh, it's too late.
Shall we schedule a public hearing and then, schedule a sidewalk and then if nobody has anything else, we can vote on the public hearing.
Sounds good.
What is your wish for a sidewalk?
Tomorrow night or Thursday night?
I won't be here tomorrow night. I could do it Thursday night. Maureen can't.
I'm out of town Thursday night.
Okay.
This is going
to
be
trying to do it when the architect's here.
How long will you be
here? Are you here, Dave?
I'm planning on leaving in the morning.
How do you feel about a site walk at 9:30?
Six o'clock.
6 a.m., right?
That schedule's flexible. I drove, so I can change that.
Okay. If everybody is free tomorrow morning, I am not, but I am very familiar with the property, so I could...
You could.
Six?
Wow.
Oh, behave.
But I can do it tomorrow.
I can do it tomorrow morning.
It's real early, which I hate. I can do it.
Eight, does eight work?
It doesn't work for me. It'd have to be like 6:30.
Oh, I could do that too.
I could do that if I had to.
Maybe 7. If it's not going to be too long, maybe 7.
7 o'clock tomorrow morning?
7's good.
Yeah, I'll try 7 then.
Scott, was that a yes?
Yeah, that was a maybe.
That was a maybe?
Yeah, I'm maybe too.
I'm going to be there at 7. You guys know.
Do it tomorrow.
Well, let me ask a different question. Is it necessary to have the architect there?
That's a good question.
I mean, can...
It's necessary to have somebody there.
Sebago Technics is local.
Right.
So perhaps...
Do we need...
The architect would know most about the details.
Right.
Yeah.
Do we need inside the building?
Access. Is that what you're asking?
Access in to get inside.
It'd be nice to get a feel for it if we could.
Okay. Well, the problem is that the part that's
we can get a key, that's why I'm asking,
is going to be demolished. So there's not a whole lot to see that you have to see there, frankly.
Which part is being demolished? Part of it's not being demolished.
Hmm?
Part of it's not being demolished.
Part of it's not part of the project, really. It's just existing.
Being renovated.
Oh.
Being renovated.
That part's not.
Is the inside
only a little
of what
bit.
Exists important enough to get into? That's what they're asking. Because they'll get a key, it sounds like.
We can look in the windows, maybe.
Well, we can get you a key, and Stephen and I are both here, so, you know, from Oregon. So if you want us to, if you'd like us to be there to explain more about operations and what would be in the building, and we'd certainly be happy to meet with you.
How long are you here for?
Till tomorrow at 5:30.
5:30
p.m.?
P.m. We were hoping to eat a little lobster, but we have plenty of time.
There you go.
None of that around here.
Yeah. I don't think it's absolutely necessary to go inside.
I'm more interested in the location of the sites on the
we can look
buildings
the
on the site, but I'd go in if we could get him.
Did you get a key by 7 o'clock? There to
I think so.
Tomorrow morning,
Stephen could probably step outside and call him right now.
Looks like at least, who can't make it tomorrow morning? And I'm not sure, so I'm assuming Scott and I and Barbara.
Maybe.
I really don't see how.
Well, why don't we just, do you feel like you know enough about the whole thing? You must,
yeah.
To give a site walk?
Whatever the pleasure of the board is, really.
Yeah,
it would work either way.
It's not that, the way I'm looking at it is it's not that important that we do this with them there, with the Sebago Technics folks available some other time.
All right.
That's my, anybody disagree with that?
So what is your pleasure?
How about Saturday morning?
That works for me.
It's fine by me.
Works for me.
I don't know if it works for me.
How about you, Paul? Jim?
Something in the back of my mind says I'm scheduled, but I can't remember what it is.
July
21st. Saturday morning works for me.
What time?
How does Saturday morning work for you?
Saturday morning?
If it's not 4 o'clock.
This is July.
This Saturday morning.
I mean, it seems to me this is the time of year we take advantage of evening and let people have weekends.
Yeah, that's why I was trying to do it on a weekday.
You can do it next week.
Yeah.
Well, do we want to
How's
do
this? Well, the,
how about next
no,
Tuesday?
The August 7th meeting before the planning board workshop.
You can do that, but I mean, that's certainly appropriate to do that.
Well,
the only thing is sometimes, and I don't think you need to in this case, but sometimes you try to get the site walk in before the submission deadline for the next meeting,
right,
in case you want the applicant to take information from the site walk and revise the plans.
I highly doubt that.
It's pretty thorough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's just to give us a sense of what we're looking at relative to the plan, more so than input. This isn't about, you know, where we're citing something like the project we had on Shore Road.
There are people who can't make August workshop.
I won't be here.
Well, I understand that. I'm just saying most of us have that blocked off. It's committed time anyway. Who can't?
Scott
can't make it either. You can't make August 7th either.
No.
I'm not going to be here, so.
My vote would be to do it right. When's that meeting? 6:30?
7 o'clock.
Yeah. 6:15.
6:15.
6:15.
Which night?
The 7th, August 7th, the meeting, workshop meeting anyway.
Does that work for you?
What day was it?
Tuesday, August the 7th. I wouldn't set it at 6:15, I'd set it at 6 anyway.
Okay, 6.
I won't be here, but I'm just saying that. It's a pretty good-sized site.
Yep, 6 o'clock.
August 7th.
And we're on the books anyway.
All right, so two of us will be there.
Are you sending an email to us as we speak?
Sorry?
You sending an email to us as we speak?
In a moment, he has to put it in his palm pilot first.
It's old now.
I know. The 7th, 6 p.m. Now they can eat more lobster.
Now, can we have a second part of the motion?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that the application be tabled to the regular August 21st, 2007 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
What was the old name, Viking?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I move that we adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? Thank you all.
7-1, Kansas City.
7-1, wow.
Can I take a straw poll? The 21st, who's not going to be here the 21st? I know Scott and I aren't. Anyone else? No?
No, I'll be here the 21st.
I want to make sure we got a quorum, because you know we don't already.